What's up guys, welcome back to my channel. This video is going to be a little bit different. What I'm going to be talking about today is my first review, my first book review for my book club. The Girl on the Train by Paula Hawkins is the book that I'm going to be reviewing today, and I'm so excited because first of all, it's my first book review, obviously. And second of all, it was so good. So good. So for everyone participating this month, I appreciate you guys. Stay tuned to the end of the video. I do have a bit of a giveaway I'm going to be doing. My first giveaway on my channel, so I'm really excited. And I'm excited that it has to do with books, so exciting. Anyways, to jump right into it, I've wrote some notes down here, so if you see me looking at it, that's why. The main girl, Rachel, she is the main character in this book. Well, there's three different women narrating it, but she is like the main one, I think. And she is a alcoholic drunk that has lost her job. And for one thing, Rachel is drunk throughout most of the story, so her memories are very unreliable. She's never sure if something really did actually happen or not. So her whole life has completely just become this big lie. She lost her job, she has a roommate, and she doesn't want to tell her roommate that she lost her job, so she's still commuting on the train to London every day to her job, pretending that she has a job, and she literally will just sit on the train. She has this street that the train goes by every day, and she actually used to live on that street. And it was kind of her perfect little house before she became this drunk and got a divorce from her husband, Tom, who actually remarried in the story. And that brings me to the next woman in the story. Her name is Anna, and she is the new wife of the ex-husband. And he actually cheated on Rachel with Anna. So, yeah. Intense. So Rachel is obsessed with Tom, her ex, still, and like is always calling him in the story. This is how it's portrayed. She's always calling him and bothering them. One time she got so drunk that she went to their house and not stole, but I guess like picked up their newborn baby and like ran outside with it while no one was there. Like, it was just super weird. Super, like, definitely an alcoholic life for sure. Like I said, Anna was Tom's mistress. The house that Tom and Rachel used to share together is right outside the railroad tracks, like I was saying before. So she passes by it on the train every day. So when the train stops there every morning, Rachel sees this attractive, lovely, young-looking woman and her husband all the time, like, out on their porch. And so she, like, creates this fantasy in her head. She calls them Jess and Jason. And she, like, makes up these names for them. And she's just like, oh, man, they're just, like, such a good-looking couple. Like, they look like they love each other. They look like they have this perfect life. And in reality, that's not it at all. Obviously, they used to live on her old block. She imagines that they have the happy life that she has lost for herself. Until she sees Jess one day kissing a different guy while she's on the train passing the house, like the back of the house where they live. She saw Jess, the girl that she like admired and like loved. She saw her kissing another guy, cheating on Jason, apparently. So Jess is actually Megan, which is the third woman that's narrating the story. Of course, she's nothing like what Rachel had imagined her to be. She's not this perfect woman. She gets restless with Jason, who his actual name is Scott, and she ends up having an affair with her therapist. She doesn't like her married life, and she doesn't really feel like she belongs on this cute little suburban street, like, with a white picket fence. Like, she doesn't like it. She used to work in an art gallery. When she lost her job, she went adrift, pretty much. She stopped doing the things that she loved, talking to the people that she loved. She started to become bored and restless until the day she disappears, never to be seen again. And that's where it gets good, guys. But when Megan's disappearance becomes this huge tabloid story, Rachel feels that she ought to go to the police and tell them what she saw on the train was, you know, which was Megan kissing this other guy, this affair. So she, in her head, Rachel is thinking that the guy that she was kissing is responsible for her disappearance. So she goes to the police, they look into it, but she's like this drunk, uncredible witness, so it's kind of hard for them to believe her. All the stories, men are the potential killers. Although Rachel and Anna hate each other, they have something unwanted in common. Either may know enough about Megan, who's worked as a babysitter for Anna and Tom and was terrible at it. This book is full of just backstabbing and manipulation and like going behind each other's backs. It is crazy. Anna stole Rachel's husband and now gloats about it. So now that Megan has been missing, Rachel gets into Scott's life and lies and said that she's known Megan for a really long time and that she's like freaking out that she's missing and wants to help and wants to do everything that she can. She's kind of just being nosy at this point, but still wants to help. Like I felt like she was being genuine in the book about that, even though she's never even met Megan before and she's a really bad liar. The best part about this book is that the author keeps all these lies, threats, and innuendos in the book to the point where they frighten and undermine each of each other's characters. None of them really know which can be trusted or believed, and it is just so good, you guys. If it seems like I'm reading, it's because I wrote notes on here, so I had to, you know, get my thoughts on paper before I just start blabbing about this book. And I noticed that there was a lot of gaslighting in this book to where each of the three women were all made out to believe that they're being crazy about certain situations. The author does a really good job of shifting between each character and showing how the gaslighting is really represented in that. I was on the edge of my seat reading this book the whole entire time. I was just like, oh my gosh, like pins and needles. And at some time, like some nights, I couldn't read it before bed because it was too creepy for me. It was weird. I will definitely say the second part of this book is a lot more suspenseful, which is so amazing. It definitely gets really to the nitty gritty. I like definitely called it in the beginning of the book of what exactly happened and how it happened. I think I'm like really good at discovering plots before it happens in books and in movies. So it was easy for me to do that, but she still did a really good job of how you find out what happened to Megan and who was responsible for that. When Megan goes missing, Rachel's world, already profoundly messy, shifts even more farther off center and off kilter. Did Megan run away? Was she kidnapped? Is she killed? Is she dead? Like, what is going on? Just wait, you guys have to read it. I'm not gonna spoil the ending, but I definitely loved the book, and now tonight Brian and I are actually gonna watch the movie. But I definitely give this book a 10 out of 10. If I could give it a higher rating, I definitely would. I definitely recommend it, and I think you guys should check it out. Especially if you're into like thriller books, this is definitely a good one for you. Now, if you made it to the end of the video, I have already picked my second book for January, and this book is called Amy Chelsea Stacy D. And it says, never get in the car. That's what they tell you. Once you get in the car, you're dead. And when I saw this book, I was like, that's my style. That's most of the people that follow me. I feel like that's your guys' style too. So I picked this up and I got two. Meaning I'm going to be giving one away by the end of this week. So I'll go ahead and just read the back of this. There is one question nobody asked me. Why didn't you run? Kidnapped when they were just girls, Amy and her cousin Dee have been missing for 6 long years. Then one day, a 16-year-old Amy steps off of a bus and back into her old life without Dee. Amy won't talk about where she's been, what happened to her, or even what's become of Dee, much to the frustrations of her family. Though Amy has her reasons for keeping the secret, she knows the only way to move forward is to return to her past. That means risking everything, including her own life. So I was like, yes, girl, give me that shit. So you guys have a chance to win one of these books. And the way to enter for this giveaway is you have to be following me on Instagram, Snapchat, and be subscribed to my YouTube channel. And I will check. I'm going to be posting a picture of this on my Instagram. You need to comment what your favorite part of this book was and what you think stood out to you the most. Was it the betrayal? Was it the ending? I'm not gonna spoil it, but what was it? And you guys have to let me know in the comments below if you entered or not. And that's pretty much it, you guys. I hope you guys enjoyed the video. I know it's a little different than usual, but I hope my book lovers enjoyed it. And I hope you guys enjoyed the video, and I will see you guys next time. Mwah. Bye.